I'm Monica Cruz, bringing you the latest on labor organizing and worker struggles across the country. On Sunday night, members of the Graduate Educators Organization 3550, or GEO, at the University of Michigan voted to extend their strike after rejecting the plan the university offered last week. Members have been on strike since September 7th and say the university's plan does not sufficiently address any of their demands, which include robust testing and contact tracing, support for graduate student instructors working remotely, subsidies for parents and caregivers, cutting funding to campus police, and ending all ties with local law enforcement and agencies like ICE. Last week, campus residential staff joined the strike and dining workers held a slowdown. Undergrads, faculty, alumni, parents, and community members have joined the picket line and put their own demands. GEO leadership are on ongoing talks with the university administration and affirm that they will, quote, continue to withhold our labor to insist that the university create safe and just working and learning conditions for all. Now, it's important to point out that while universities across the country are saving on all the costs of in-person classes, they're still charging students full tuition. New York City Mayor de Blasio announced on Monday morning that 55 school staff members have tested positive for the virus. UFT leadership and rank and file members have expressed frustration at the city's plan to reopen schools. With in-person classes set to begin next Monday, workers at schools across the city have held rallies, picketed, and refused to enter their buildings until adequate protections are put in place. At least one walkout took place of an estimated 60 teachers at a school in Brooklyn. Workers have also taken to social media to denounce the delays in the city's contact tracing system and document the battered conditions in schools. Others have criticized the cash-strapped DOE for spending money on Twitter ads insisting that schools are reopening safely. UFT President Michael Mulgrew, who signed the deal with the DOE just over a week ago, told NBC, quote, if the city can't live up to its side of this agreement, then we're going to say you can't open. The family of a meat plant worker who died from COVID is speaking out against the Trump Labor Department's decision to fine a multi-billion dollar meat processing company, JBS Foods, only a little over $15,000 for neglecting the safety of the workers throughout the pandemic and essentially working them into their graves. Saul Sanchez was the first out of 8 workers to die from the virus at the plant in Greeley, Colorado. Sanchez's daughter calls the fine a slap in the face as the company made $51 billion last year. The Occupational Safety and Health Administration announced the penalty a day after it had fined Smithfield Foods almost $14,000 for failing to protect its employees from the coronavirus. Over 12,000 Smithfield workers in South Dakota have tested positive for COVID-19 and 4 have died. Outbreaks at meat processing plants have been well documented across the U.S., with workers pointing to totally absent PPE and social distancing in the factories. According to the Food Environmental Reporting Network, more than 42,000 meatpacking workers have been infected, and at least 203 have died from the virus since March.